Right, hello everyone, and welcome to our very first online talk in science of 2021. It's a pleasure to have you join us this evening. My name is Wendy, and I work in the public engagement team at Darsby Laboratory, and we work for the Science and Technology Facilities Council, or STFC. Darsby Laboratory is one of STFC national laboratories based in Cheshire, and we have two other national laboratories based in Edinburgh and Oxfordshire. So who is STFC? Well, STFC is one of Europe's largest research organisations. We enable the UK's natural sciences, together with the computing and engineering communities, to carry out their world-leading research. And we do this by working with universities, national laboratories, regional campuses, and scientific facilities right across the UK and abroad. We look at a whole range of science, from the smallest particles that we know of, right through to objects in outer space and the mysteries of our universe. Talking science is one part of the outreach that we do. So I know we have quite a number of new people here tonight, and I want to point out that you can see and hear us, but we cannot see or hear you. We do, however, have a questions and answer button at the bottom of the screen, so you can type your questions in there, and we will get through as many questions as we possibly can. In addition, we will not be including subtitles, but we can offer recording after the event for those who request it. So without further ado, I would like to welcome Professor Carsten Welsch. Carsten studied physics and economics at the universities of Frankfurt in Germany and UC Berkeley in the USA. His career took him to Tokyo in Japan, Heidelberg in Germany, and Geneva in Switzerland, where he worked for CERN. He founded his Quasar group, which is Quantum Systems and Advanced Accelerator Research, in 2007. And joined the University of Liverpool and the Cockcroft Institute in 2008. The Cockcroft Institute is a partnership between a number of universities and STFC. He was promoted to professorship in 2011 and appointed as head of department in 2016. Quite a phenomenal career so far, I think you'll agree. His research focuses on the development of particle accelerators and light sources, in particular on the development of devices that can monitor the properties of charged particle beams. Professor Welsch has been a partner in numerous national and international research projects. Amongst others, he has coordinated 9 large-scale EU projects to date. He's a member of numerous international advisory committees and a frequent speaker at international workshops and conferences. But most importantly in my book, he's a really familiar face for STFC public engagement. So without further ado, I will hand over to you, Carsten. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Wendy, for that kind introduction and a very warm welcome, everybody, in particular, any children and teenagers joining us tonight. The evening is all about science. Talking science is in the title, and I hope that I can share my passion for science and also my passion for Hollywood movies with you. Behind me, you see a photograph of the Griffith Observatory, which is just outside of Los Angeles, looking down on LA and also on Hollywood, and really a fantastic place to go. So tonight, I'm gonna try and share some of the Hollywood magic with you and also have a look behind the scenes of a number of blockbusters. So let me share my screen with you. Now have this large on your screens, and I'm going to kick that off. Here we go. So Hollywood physics is the title of tonight's talks. And as I said, what I'm going to try is look at some of the big blockbusters from recent years and look into with you and with your engagement into where do they get the science right and where are they fundamentally very wrong. And very importantly, I'm also going to try to connect this with the research that's happening here at Darsbury at the Cockcroft Institute and show you that a lot of this is at least equally exciting as some of the biggest Hollywood hits. In terms of what I have on the agenda, so here's just in a nutshell what we are going to cover. We are going to start with a number of superheroes. We are going to start with The Flash and then continue via Iron Man until we get to the Terminator 3 movie. and its signs. And finally, we will conclude with Angels and Demons, a film that has signs at the very core of it, and look into where they got it right and where did they get it wrong. What we are going to talk about is, the films primarily, but then also the research that me and my group are conducting into particle accelerators. We are going to talk about superheroes. We are talking a lot about new technologies, and we are also going to cover antimatter. So I think there's a lot of interesting things that are going to be covered tonight. And as Wendy said in the introduction, if you have any questions, please do pop them into the Q&A chat window, and we will pick those up in between. I have several breaks arranged in the talk, and Wendy and I, we will then pick up your questions and answer these live. So please do submit them as they come up. So let's start with the first film, which is The Flash. And I think before we go into the details, I would like to see how much you know these different films. And I'd like to ask Wendy to show us the first poll for the audience. So here you get to tell us what you already know about these films. So our first poll is about The Flash, the television series, and how did The Flash actually get his superpowers? Was he bitten by a spider? Does he actually come from another planet? Did he get them from a particle accelerator? Did he get them from an infinity stone? Or is The Flash actually a mutant? So we'll give you just a couple of seconds more until we have a decent amount of answers coming in.
So we're just going past 100. Yeah. We'll let it go a little bit longer because I think some people might have to think about this a little bit. There's probably a few debates going on at home at the moment.
It's a tricky one.
This is very, very interesting. We have got a clear winner coming through.
Shall we have a look at the winner?
Shall we have a look? Okay.
Okay, so the clear winner is a particle accelerator. Well, I guess the first one, bitten by a spider, that's our neighborhood spider, Peter Parker, and not The Flash. Coming from another planet, that's maybe Superman, but again, not The Flash. He's also not a mutant. So the correct answer is indeed a particle accelerator. Let's have a look at how that actually happened.
Primary cooling system. Officials are now trying to shut down the particle accelerator, but so far have been unable to regain control of the system.
What you could see here is how Hollywood Pictures' a particle accelerator experiment go quite wrong. So there is this big explosion, the accelerator goes up, and a flash of light, and then also a second flash hitting The Flash here in the photograph, and that's how he gets his superpowers. So I guess for us that leaves two questions to be answered. Firstly, can particle accelerators create superpowers? And I'll come back to that question a little bit later. And the second question, I guess, is also much more down to earth. What are actually particle accelerators and what are they used for? And to answer that question, I'm going to take you on a journey and I'm going to take you to Geneva in Switzerland. So whilst we're going there, we are going to an organization called CERN, the European Center for Nuclear Research. And that's based just outside of Geneva. On the right-hand side of this photograph here, you can see Lake Geneva. You can also see on the photograph Geneva Airport, which is here. And then you see that huge circle, 27 kilometers in circumference. And that's the world's largest particle accelerator, the Large Hadron Collider, LHC, where scientists from all over the world are conducting fundamental research experiments. So that tells us where the accelerator is. It doesn't tell us what an accelerator actually is. And for that, we'll have a look at a second movie. So here we start with a bottle of hydrogen gas and we ionize that gas. We send it into a first linear accelerator before we go into a ring-shaped accelerator, and each single one of them is almost like a gear shift in a car, propelling our particles to higher and higher energies. From the first circular accelerator, we go into a larger ring, which is called the proton synchrotron. And that's where the particles are already very, very close to the speed of light. That's not enough for us. We want to go to even higher energies. And at CERN, that means we are next going into the super proton synchrotron, a machine that is already larger than a kilometer in circumference. And from that machine on, we go into the world's largest and highest energy particle accelerator, the Large Hadron Collider. And in the very center of that accelerator, we have four different types of detectors, big, big underground installations. And in the center of these detectors, that's where we collide the particle beams. And that's where we are trying to understand the very origin of all of us and everything in the universe. In fact, some of the experiments, they take us back 13.6 billion years in time, all the way to the beginning of the universe and to the Big Bang itself, because that's how long some of the particles that particle physicists are analyzing have not been seen free anywhere in the universe. So really, really exciting research happening at CERN and looking into the origins of matter. Now, you might say, well, that's good, but I'm not that much into fundamental research. Aren't there any more immediate effects? Aren't there any benefits from particle accelerators that affect everyday life in a different way? And there are, for example, medical applications. And one of these is proton beam cancer therapy, a very recent development in the UK to tackle cancer, specific types of cancer, by using protons and heavy ion beams. Now, what you can see here on this slide is how a physicist pictures you on a physics plot. On the x-axis, you can see the depths of some radiation in water, and water represents your body. You are, unfortunately, by 95% water, so our representation of the human body is typically just a block of water. And what you can see is that on that axis, we go all the way from 0 centimeters, which is our skin, up until a depth of 30 centimeters inside of your body. So now imagine that, unfortunately, you have developed a cancer somewhere, either in your head or deep in your body, then this is kind of the depths that we would have to go into if we want to destroy the cancer. So if we want to destroy any cell, including cancer cells, we need to deposit some energy at the location of the cancer, because ultimately we want to kill it, we want to burn it, we want to destroy it. And for that, we need to put energy into the right area of space. And we can do this with different types of radiation. And the radiation that probably all of you know are X-rays. X-rays are used by doctors all of the time, whether it's to have a look at your teeth or if you have a bike or skiing accident and you might need an X-ray to look into your arm or leg to see if there's any fracture. Now, one of the properties of X-rays is that they go all the way through your body. And that's exactly what you can see in this plot. You can see the yellow line starts on the left-hand side. It then has some bump, and then it goes all the way to 30 centimeters. And across the entire region, it deposits some energy. Now, that has good news and it has bad news. The good news is we can go all the way through the body. So no matter where the cancer is, we could put some energy also into the cancer cells. The not so good news is that you can see that a lot of the energy is already deposited in the first few centimeters. And if you are talking about a deep-seated tumor in your head or for example, prostate cancer in men, then this is not where we would like to deposit the energy. We would really like to spare the healthy tissue at the beginning and only irradiate after a certain depth inside the body. So it is okay, but it's not optimum. The second solution that you may have heard of are to use electron beams. And here you can see that the situation is even less favorable, because firstly, you can see it doesn't even reach all the way through the body. So after 12, 13 centimeters, there's nothing left. The energy that is still left drops to zero, and we can't deposit any energy deeper into the body of a patient. We have a similar effect to X-rays in that a lot of the energy is already wasted very, very early on, so at skin level or maybe a few centimeters deep in the patient's body. So clearly not an ideal scenario. Now comes our magic bullet, and these are heavy ion beams. And that's where really the world changes altogether. So what you can see here is that we deposit essentially all of the energy at a well-defined depth that is deep in the body of the patient, or that is, in this case, 25 centimeters along the x-axis. So this is exactly the kind of scenario we wanted. We wanted to deposit the energy where we need it, where we know that the tumor is located, and we wanted to deposit as low a dose as possible in the entrance channel. And that's exactly what you can see here on that plot, and that's exactly the big, big advantage of proton beam therapy over any other radiation therapy for some specific cancer types. Now, similar to the movie that I've shown before, I've also a movie for a medical accelerator, and you will see it's almost the same as the film about the accelerator at CERN. We start from a particle source, go through a linear accelerator into a circular machine, and then through a beam transport system, we now don't go into the LHC, but we go into a patient treatment room. So we guide the beam of charged particles to the patient, and we irradiate the patient from a direction, from an angle where it is needed, and we can deliver exactly the right dose to exactly the right places. And that's an absolute game changer that came to the UK in terms of heavy proton beam therapy at high energies only 2 years ago. And the number of centers that will allow that kind of treatment are now being established by the NHS and also by private providers. So really game-changing technology, and very much directly based on the technologies that are used to do fundamental research at facilities like CERN in Geneva, Switzerland. So that's a lot of information already in Daresbury and at the Cockcroft Institute. We are very much pioneering new ways of using that kind of therapy, either with protons or heavy ions. And one of our projects, it's called OMA, Optimization of Medical Accelerators. And it puts us in the forefront of a very large international collaboration combining more than 40 institutions all across Europe, and all of them having the target of improving cancer care for specific cancer types. And Daresbury and Cockcroft are very much leading the way in this area. So that's maybe a good time to have a short pause and see if there's any questions from you, anything that already came up, either related to research at CERN, to medical applications, or also to the flash film, where I will come back to the question of superpowers a little bit later.
I think people are still digesting that information. We're blinding them with a bit of science here. So I'm sure we'll get more questions coming in along the way. I'll let you know, Carsten.
Brilliant. So the next film I wanted to talk about is another superhero. And in this case, it's Iron Man, as you can see here. And again, I think we should start this section with a short poll, which Wendy, if you could kindly open this to the audience.
Yep, no problem. Gemma's going to launch that for me now.
Brilliant. So again, for Iron Man, we would like to know how much you know already about the films. And the question is, what inventions did Tony Stark, the Iron Man himself, make? Did he invent a hover car? Did he invent a special suit that gives him Iron Man powers? Did he invent a new element that ultimately saved his life? Did he invent Captain America's shield? And did he invent Spider-Man's advanced suit? So you can select multiple ones in this poll. And there might be one correct answers, two correct answers, five correct answers, or all of them might be wrong.
And if you've never seen the film, you could just guess and enjoy joining in. We do have some questions as well that have come in, Carsten, which we could probably have a look at shortly.
I'll keep those for the next break. Let's have a look at the poll results. Tony Stark did invent the special suit that gives him Iron Man powers. About the other ones, the hover car, So in the Iron Man films, there is actually a hover car that was invented, but not by Tony Stark, but by his father already. A new element that saved his life, that is correct. And that's what we are going to talk about in just a second. Captain America's shield, again, something that not Tony Stark, but his father invented. And then last and not least, he also invented Spider-Man's advanced suit, but that's not something we are going to cover today. So the element that saved his life, let's have a look at how Tony actually did that experiment.
Initializing with prismatic accelerator. Approaching maximum power.
So that's how Hollywood imagines work of Tony Stark in his laboratory. I would just call this just another day in the office because that's how we do experiments at the Cockcroft Institute all of the time. No, I mean, there's just so many things which are fundamentally incorrect, but let's look at what he actually did in this scene. So he builds up this particle accelerator at home. A storage that is propelling particles to higher energies. And that's maybe not unrealistic. I think if you have the right RF power at home and you connect some vacuum chambers, you could probably do that. And then you see that he has absolutely zero safety features. And he at some point simply removes that particle beam from its surrounding vacuum chamber and he fires it all across the room. Destroys much of the inventory until he finally guides the beam towards his experiment, which is actually this triangular shaped object where he combines the beam with that object and that creates a new element, which then is placed into his body to protect his heart from some iron pieces that have been in his body since the first Iron Man movie. He also does quite a bit of fine tuning of the machine, as you can see by using that ginormous wrench. And that of course is also not something that we would do in our labs. When we are talking about colliding particle beams in the LHC, for example, the two beams that are colliding, they are colliding with a cross section that is only 16 nanometers large. So that's a thousandth of a millionth of a meter and is absolutely tiny. So by steering that beam, there would be no way whatsoever to use anything close to that wrench. And similar to the patient treatment that I mentioned earlier, when we are delivering a particle beam to a patient, we want to know with sub-millimeter precision where exactly we are depositing that energy. And for that, we really need extremely carefully designed diagnostics that tells us at any point in time where the particle beam is inside the patient and inside of the accelerator. Now, the main purpose of Tony's experiment here is to create that new element that nobody had done before and that ultimately can save his life. And you might be surprised, but creating new elements is actually something that scientists have done for a number of years and they have been using, you may have guessed that by now, particle accelerators. The facility that is really famous for that is something that's very close to my hometown, just a 20-minute drive, and is a facility where I worked as an undergraduate student and also as a PhD student many years ago. It's called Facility for Antiproton and Ion Research and is based at Darmstadt in Germany. You can see it has a considerable size. The reason why that is a rendered picture rather than a photograph is that this facility is currently undergoing a very, very significant extension, and the UK is actually one of the key partners in the future experiments. And this will open completely new experimental opportunities. And here again, we are using accelerators. So the particle beam in this case starts in the left-hand side of the photograph. It then travels along the buildings and is entered into a first circular ring, which is in this building here, until it is further accelerated until finally it reaches the experiments or where the new elements are created. Now, these new elements use exactly the same technologies as the ones that I've shown at CERN, as the ones that I've shown that are used in hospitals. And here they are used to very, very carefully combine different particle beams and create elements that have not been seen on our world and in most of the universe freely. Creating these new elements is difficult, and every time it happens, it's a major breakthrough. This is when you can read in the newspapers that a new element has been named and that the periodic table of elements has been extended to include a new element. And some of these are actually named after the facility. So there is now an element which is called Darmstadtium, named after the city. And there's also another one which is called Hessium, named after the state of Hessen, where Darmstadt is based. So you can see that the facilities, the surrounding area contribute actually to naming these elements. How is the detection done? It's done in installations like this one. It's an experiment called Ship Trap. And in Ship Trap, these elements are very, very carefully analyzed. And there's only one particle amongst so, so many over a very long time scale. So scientists have to be extremely careful in detecting those. So it's nowhere close to what Tony Stark did, and he just irradiates a target, and then you have a new element, which you can then use, and which is basically then an off-the-shelf product almost. No, these are tiny, tiny quantities of these elements, but they are very important so that physicists can understand how all matter is composed of and also what the properties of these exotic particles are. Okay, so I see that there's a number of questions that came in. So maybe a good time to take a short breath and have a look at these questions. So the first question that came in, and I'm just gonna go through these a bit chronologically, and Wendy, maybe you can then also pick out some of these. We have quite a number already now. How large a room do we need to create to house a collider in a hospital? That's a very good question. And that's an important element in determining the total cost of a specific treatment. As you've seen from the film, the size of the accelerator is quite considerable, in particular when compared to the size of a treatment room. So for the synchrotron-based facilities, and that's the one that was shown in the film, we do in fact need almost a building for the accelerator itself, and that's a significant cost factor. And that's also why I was careful in always saying that this is an advantageous therapy for some specific cancer types. So it's not a treatment opportunity that will now benefit every cancer patient. It really has to be judged against other treatment opportunities. And also the complexity of the treatment has to be considered when it comes to different types of cancer. So it is definitely an infrastructure that requires quite significant housing, and that is something important to be considered. The second facility that is built by the NHS is actually going to be based in London, in the center of London, where, as you can imagine, property prices are quite extreme. So the size of the facility there did have considerable impact on the design of the facility. And Rod, a good question. The first proton-based facility is actually based at the Christie in Manchester. So that's the first UK-based high-energy proton beam treatment facility. It's not the first proton beam cancer treatment facility, because at Clatteridge, for many, many years, and as one of the very first in the world, eye tumors have been treated by also using proton beams. But the eye is a very small object, and the beam only needs to penetrate a few centimeters. So the energy of the particle beam can be quite low. And that means the beams that are used at Clatteridge are not suitable for treating many of the other cancer types. Wendy, were there any questions from the audience that you found particularly interesting? I see there's quite a number of them.
Yeah, there's quite a variety there. I think if we just go down as many as we can, and those that we can't answer, we can leave at the end, and maybe we could answer them after the event by email. So should we see how we go on?
Yep.
Okay, so Toby's written in here. What would it actually look like if a particle accelerator failed?
So what I should say first and foremost is safety is of utmost importance for any high energy accelerator, as you may have guessed. So the safety systems in a machine like the LHC has many, many different layers, and all are meant to prevent any major damage to the machine, to the detectors, and of course, of the staff that are working at CERN and at the related experiments. For the next generation accelerator, the upgrade of the LHC, the systems that are in place right now, they will even not be sufficient, and there will be additional security and safety layers installed. What would happen if something goes still wrong? We got an idea of that a few years ago when there was an accident at CERN, and where one of the superconducting magnets all of a sudden lost its superconducting properties. What happened was that the beam itself didn't suffer anything. It was very safely dumped before anything could happen. But in the machine itself, that loss of superconducting state led to magnets being displaced and quite some damage in some of the elements that then required a lengthy replacement procedure. There are things that can go wrong. But fundamentally, the machines are now designed to such a high level and with so many safety layers that this is something that was a singular incident, which I'm sure will not happen again in the form it took some 10 years ago. Now, a good question about Daspberry. I always like to talk also about our local facility, not just the very large infrastructures abroad. So the one at CERN is the biggest in the world. There's nothing that comes anywhere close to it. It's the largest scientific experiment by far. At Daspberry, it's much more compact. And actually, the nice photographs that Wendy has in the background of her Zoom image, that gives you an idea of the scale of Daspberry Lab. And there you can see on the left-hand side the tower, and that's actually where an accelerator used to be placed inside in the past. And from left to right, we are talking about maybe 200 meters, and that's where all of our accelerators at Daspberry are currently based in. We do have plans for larger infrastructures also in the UK. We are talking about next generation light sources, for example, and these would be considerable infrastructures, not quite the size of CERN, but maybe something up to a kilometer in length.
Right, lots and lots of questions here. Yes. How many centers in the UK can offer this particle medical therapy?
Yeah, important. Question. So the Christie Hospital started treating cancers using high energy proton beams 2 years ago, and the hospital in London will start or shall start operation later this year. There's an additional 3 proton beam therapy centers that are in the planning in the UK, and I'm sure as we will see the success coming out from these treatments, we will also see more centers coming up. There's many more centers around the world. Overall, we have now a few dozens of proton and heavy ion beam cancer therapy centers in Europe, in the US, in Japan in particular. And it's a more and more established treatment opportunity. Okay. Maybe one more at this time?
Have you got enough time at the moment to carry on, or what would you like, Carsten?
I think we can probably take one more question, and then we take others just a little bit later.
How does your knowledge change the way you watch sci-fi or Marvel movies?
So normally it has different layers. When I'm in the cinema, I'm just enjoying the film as much as anybody else. I love science fiction movies, no matter how crazy they are. And then at some point, maybe at work in particular in the office, when we are talking about just how crazy some of these films are and how they turn the science upside down, that's where then the physics kicks in, and when we are looking at how things would look like in real life. But it doesn't disturb me watching and enjoying the film in the cinema whatsoever. Okay, let's continue and let's look into another movie. that I'm sure that many of you have at least heard of, the Terminator movie series. The story in the Terminator is that there are, in the distant future, there's a war going on between humans and machines. And in order to balance the war, one side or the other, they have also invented time travel. And one of the fundamental parts of the story is that both humans and cyborgs, they travel back in time to basically kill the people that have originated robot technology in the 1990s, 2000s. And they have bitter fights both in the future and in the present day. And in Terminator 3, there's quite an advanced cyborg, which is the one on the right-hand side. It's the friendly looking lady, at least the left part of her face. She is a shapeshifter, so she can transform into almost any possible shape, and she's made out of an advanced metal that allows her to do this. So if we could have the next polygemma maybe for the Terminator film. So that Terminator is called TX or Terminatrix. And what I would like to know from you is, how was the TX captured? Was it by using kryptonite? Was it by using a strong magnet? Was the Terminator molten in fire? Were the Terminator captured by the police? Or were they sent into a black hole? Let's have a look. All right, so lots of experts here and lots of answers. Many thanks for engaging tonight. That's really enjoyable for us. So kryptonite, that's clearly Superman. By the police, okay. That was not a good answer. I'll give you that. I'll change that for next time. Sent into a black hole, that would be an interesting experiment, but maybe that was too expensive for the Hollywood special effects. Molten in fire. So there is a Terminator that gets thrown into fire and then is almost destroyed, but not quite, but that's in the Terminator 2 film. In the Terminator 3 movie, the Terminatrix that's shown here is actually captured by a very strong magnetic field. So if again, we have a short look at how that's looking, and because we have also some younger members of the audience, I'm not going to show the film because anything that involves Arnold Schwarzenegger has a lot of pieces flying around. And is not very audience friendly. So that's the key scene here. In order to capture the Terminatrix, they lure her into the tunnel of, you may have guessed it, a particle accelerator. So they are running down the tunnel of the accelerator, and at some point from the remote control station, they are switching on the magnets, and then the magnets, because the cyborg is made of metal, the magnet attracts the cyborg, and you can see her now sticking against that magnet. And that's where she can no longer move. And the good guys, they manage to escape from her. Now, my question to you is, who would ever design a magnet that has the purpose of bending a particle beam inside of a vacuum chamber that has an extremely strong magnetic field outside of that vacuum chamber? What we really want is that for that magnetic field to be concentrated very much in the core of where the particle beam is, not in the tunnel where people are walking around. So there's so much wrong with this scene that I'm not even sure where to start with. I think what I can definitely focus on is the question of, where do we use very high magnetic fields? And coming back to what I showed a little bit earlier about the experiments at CERN, this is one of the detectors that I used underground. It's a detector called ATLAS, and it's the largest of all the detectors. It is very large indeed. In the center, you can see a scientist standing inside of the detector, and that was during the construction phase. The whole cavern that houses the detector is so large that it could house all of the Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris. And it's 100 meters underneath the ground. And that just shows you the complexity of these very, very large scientific installations. in the center of this detector, so that's very much in the center of your screen at the moment, that's where the particle beams collide, and that's where then the new physics happens, and that's where scientists want to understand in great detail what is happening inside of detectors. And this animation here again shows you what's going on there. The two beams collide, and then there's lots of different fragments happening. And the task of physicists is to then analyze all of these trajectories and understand exactly what is going on in this experiment. Now, to analyze the data, the world needs to work together. It's not possible by any individual research organization, not even CERN, to analyze all of the data. So a worldwide grid, a computing system that involves very powerful computer stations all around the world, works together to analyze the data 24/7. And this requires very complex algorithms. It now also includes machine learning techniques to really filter out those events that are new, that show us something that we haven't seen maybe ever. And that's where new discoveries happen, such as the discovery of the Higgs particle that you may have heard of and that gave the Nobel Prize to scientists in 2012. In Liverpool and also at Darsbury through the Hartree Center, we have a lot of research into big data techniques. Lift.dat is a doctoral training center where 36 PhD students at the moment carry out research into cutting edge data science applications, including accelerator research, but also including astrophysics, particle physics, nuclear physics, and condensed matter physics. So really a lot of scientific disciplines all working together. So that's what I wanted to say about the Terminator film and the related magnetic field challenges and then the data techniques, and maybe a good time to have a look at a few more questions before we come to the last part of the talk. Wendy, any particular ones that you'd like to answer, to have answered at this point?
Yeah, let's take a look. Paul asks, what is the heaviest element that can be created?
Oh, that's a good question. So, Paul, I would say that fundamentally, we are always trying to push the boundaries. There's no theoretical limit to what we can combine. So I think it's really about pushing the threshold higher and higher.
Brilliant answer. Okay, Keith is asking, what tends to be the lifespans of new heavy particles when they are created? Do they rapidly deteriorate?
Yes, most of them. Most of them, they are extremely short-lived. And that's why we need these very sophisticated sensors that capture them the fraction of a second that they are actually with us. And that has to be enough to determine their properties. And in the early days, some of the elements, you could almost give them names because there were so few of them. And that is a big challenge to filter out just the few events that are relevant, and then at the same time to characterize these particles in great detail.
Okay, Isabel is asking, how often are new elements made?
So for some of the elements, it has taken 5 or even up to 10 years to create them. So there is a very significant collaboration between theorists that are looking into elements that may exist, and then the experimentalists ultimately have to show that this is really happening. And so when there is a prediction of a particular element, then of course the experimentalists, they want to accept that challenge, and they want to show whether or not it is really there, and ultimately verify or test wrong the theory that's underpinning that predicted data. So some of the experiments, they are being carried out over extremely long time spans, well beyond, say, for example, a PhD thesis time span.
Okay, thank you. Graham's asking, how does CERN compensate for very small movements underground?
That's an excellent question. Many thanks for that. Some of the movements are actually not that small. I mentioned, for instance, that the Atlas cavern is 100 meters underground, and it has a size large enough to house Notre Dame Cathedral. Now, what happens if you immerse basically a bubble of air into a solid, so the Earth, or into water, it goes up. And the Atlas cavern does go up by roughly a millimeter per year. Now compare that with the 16 nanometer cross-section of the beams, and you see that you have a problem in that you need to steer those beams. What you can also see is you can see high-speed trains entering Geneva. So you can see on the readings of the particle accelerator when the train is arriving. And you can imagine that at the beginning, when nobody knew what would affect these measurements, all of a sudden there was all this data that showed that something is happening in the accelerator, and nobody knew what was going on until they correlated this with the arrival and departure times of these high-speed trains. So to compensate this, there are specific elements in the machine that you wouldn't require if everything was perfect as simulated in the computer. But that's never the case, so you always need some correctors. So these are small magnets that either bend the beam a little bit up or down or left or right, or that focus it a little bit more if that's needed. And these correctors are then compensating for any of these movements.
Okay, have we got time for one more?
Yeah, I think we can take one more, yeah.
I've chosen this one because it's making me smile. Eliza is saying, my father has just bought a classic car, a DeLorean, which he is keeping to modify. He just wondered if you knew where he could get hold of a flux capacitor.
Well, I guess we are working on it. Back to the Future is one of my favorite movie series. And I've given a talk about the science of Back to the Future some time ago. So maybe your dad and I, we should get together and have a chat about these films. Okay, so let me carry on with my last Hollywood blockbuster. And that's, I think, a very exciting one, because in the very core of it is science, and quite extreme science, namely building an antimatter bomb. The film I'm talking about is also a best-selling book by Dan Brown. It's called Angels and Demons, and it was turned into a Hollywood film starring Tom Hanks some 10 years ago, maybe even longer. For those who haven't seen it, the story in a nutshell is as follows. So the book says that there's a group of crazy scientists, and they are working at a big international laboratory called CERN. And at CERN, they are using a fantastic machine called the Large Hadron Collider to create a very exotic type of matter, namely antimatter. Now, the bad guys in the plot, they are going to CERN and they are stealing that antimatter, because antimatter has a very specific property. If you bring it together with matter, it annihilates and it creates pure energy. So all of the mass between matter and antimatter that you combine is turned with 100% efficiency into nothing but energy. So what these guys have plotted is take the antimatter from CERN, put it into a device called a particle trap, take that particle trap to the Vatican in Rome, and then annihilate the antimatter and blow up the Vatican to kill the Pope. So that's, in a nutshell, the plot of the Angels and Demons movie. And by now, I guess you are all investigators and scientists. And so I guess we can have a conversation about what is real science and what is fiction in this book. Now, the first question is an easy one. The book is centered around CERN, a laboratory where the world works together. And by now, you know that CERN does exist. And it's again depicted here next to Geneva, an international organization really making the world collaborate. The greatest minds from all around the planet are gathering at CERN in order to advance knowledge and also to create technologies that then benefit society. Now, scientists in the book, they are extremely busy, and they have to go to conferences and workshops all of the time. And because they are so busy, they can't waste time on just standard airplanes. So CERN has an X-33 hypersound airplane. And with that airplane, they can go to anywhere on the planet in about 2 hours. Now, unfortunately, that's absolutely not true. Economy class is also what is applicable to CERN scientists. And when scientists go to scientific workshops or conferences, whether they are in Australia or the United States, they travel with the airplanes that everybody else is using. Another interesting feature in the book is that because the scientists have to think all the time so hard, they also need to relax a little bit. And that's why CERN have their own wind tunnel on site. And in the lunch break, the scientists, they just leave their offices and they go into that wind tunnel and they fly around a little bit. Now, I'm afraid that's also not true. And that doesn't exist at CERN. However, there is really excellent skiing. So as Wendy said at the beginning, I did work at CERN for 3 years of my life, and my office was based in the Prévesin site in France. And during winter time, we would often go skiing just during lunch break, an extended lunch break, arguably, but the skiing slope were just 5 minutes away from the office. So you could easily relax and take a break from thinking in the morning and afternoon via skiing. What's also in the book is that they say there are these secret laboratories where antimatter is created. And in order to get into these laboratories, they claim that scientists have to do an iris scan to get access. And at the time when the book was written, that was complete nonsense, because every lab at CERN was freely accessible. If there were any radiation issues, then what you would use is your CERN access card, and you would get access to these sites by using your card. Now, the book almost has a visionary element in with regards to these access codes, because now they do have iris scanners in some of the laboratories, and sometimes you do get access only if you use these. So who knows, secret laboratories, not that secret, but the way to get access to these laboratories is sometimes via iris scanners. And the last question about crazy scientists at CERN, well, I guess I have to find a political answer to that one. And I would say maybe some at CERN, at Darsbury, at other places, some of scientists are crazy. And I guess that's also what makes science so interesting. Now, we know that the LHC exists at CERN. It is the most powerful accelerator ever built, and it has been in operation since 2009. And right now it is undergoing a major upgrade, which will make it even more powerful and give us more insight into nature in the future. Now, is the LHC used for the production of an exotic element called antimatter? Well, the LHC does produce all sorts of particles, including antimatter, but it is not by any means an antimatter factory. But there is a facility at CERN which is actually an antimatter factory, and that's the antiproton decelerator and the Elena ring that is shown here. So there is a dedicated particle accelerator at CERN that creates a very exotic element called antimatter. So how do we actually produce antimatter in the laboratory? Well, let's have a look. What we do is we take a very high energy beam of protons and we fire it onto a target. And that target is just a block of metal. Could be any metal, but something with a good heat conductivity would be nice. So when you fire a lot of energy into a small region of space, the one physics equation that probably all of you know is E equals mc squared. Energy is equal to the mass of the particle times the velocity of light squared. So if I put enough energy into a specific point of space, I can create mass. The equation doesn't tell me anything about what mass I'm creating. And then we have to look into probabilities. And with some small probability, I will create antimatter. In fact, for every 1 million protons that I'm firing onto that metal block, I will create just one antiproton. So it's a very low yield. It's a very difficult process, but it allows us to create antimatter. We can then capture these particles and we can use them for precision experiments. In Liverpool at the Cockcroft Institute, also in Manchester, we have again a large scale project called AVA, Accelerators Validating Antimatter Research. And in that project, we are investigating the properties of antimatter, and we are also looking into the accelerators, the detectors, the instrumentation that is required to understand that mirror image of matter better and to understand where all the antimatter has left, because there is no free antimatter in the universe, and what are the specific properties of the antimatter that we create in our labs. Now, can we transport antimatter to the Vatican? The image that I've included here is one that I found from The Guardian at the time when they illustrated the Angels and Demons film. And this is the device that they are using in the film to transport antimatter and then take it to the Vatican in Rome. And I guess up until recently, the answer to that was no. The only place where we are doing experiments with antimatter is at CERN. But again, you could call the book quite visionary, because that's not quite right anymore. In fact, there's a new scientific project which was just approved via the European Research Council, and that's a project called Base Step. And what these guys are going to do is they are going to develop a particle trap which is going to capture antimatter at CERN and then take it to a laboratory, not in Rome, but in Germany, where they will study the properties of these exotic particles in more detail. And one of the reasons is actually related to the question you asked earlier on, what about vibrations? What about disturbances? CERN is not necessarily a place that is extremely quiet, because there's so many things going on. There are laboratories that are much more quiet, much more stable, and we can do some of the experiments with much higher precision if we have such an environment. So the motivation for these studies is to find out more about antimatter and do that in a more quiet environment. So Base Step is now making reality what Angels and Demons, you could say, predicted more than a decade ago. So back to the original question, can we build an antimatter bomb, or what is needed to build an antimatter bomb? Now, let's do a little experiment. What if matter meets antimatter? So what I explained earlier on is that the process of annihilation means that if I take a certain amount of matter and I combine it with a certain amount of antimatter and I bring the two together, so the moment they touch, they turn into pure light, pure energy. There's nothing left. It's 100% conversion of the mass of these two blocks of matter into energy. So I'm going to show you a particle, and it has a name, and I'm sure that all of you know the antiparticle of that particular particle. So my particle is called Anakin, and Anakin is shown here. And the antiparticle of Anakin, of course, is Darth Vader. So now let's do that Gedanken experiment, and let's say these two are meeting and they are shaking hands. Let's just take, for the sake of the argument, a weight each of 100 kilograms, and then we are coming back to the equation that I mentioned earlier, E equals mc squared. So in this case, the energy released is equal to the mass that disappears, so 2 times 100 kilograms, multiplied by the velocity of light squared. Now, that's a lot of energy that's going to be released. If you do the calculation, you will find it's 5 trillion kilowatt hours. And that's the equivalent of the yearly output of 500 nuclear power plants. It's also identical to the energy of 4,200 megatons of TNT. So if you put together 100 kilograms of matter and 100 kilograms of antimatter, this is where the idea of a bomb comes from. Now, for our two friends here, Anakin and Darth Vader, I guess what it means is never invite them together to your party, because it's gonna create a mess. Now, is it a threat? I guess that's then something we have to be much more careful with, because a threat would mean, firstly, we look into the efficiency of that process. And that's what I said now a couple of times. We are looking into the energy released compared to the mass of the fuel that we are using. And for annihilation, that's 100%. And that's so much different from nuclear fission or nuclear fusion, where the efficiency is only 0.1% or so. And for chemical fuel, like the petrol that we have in our cars, it's much, much less than that. So it is really a lot more efficient, or if you put it into some military jargon, you could say you get 1,000 times more bang for the gram of antimatter. So creating a bomb with antimatter would be so much more efficient than creating a bomb out of any other material, really. Now, can we blow up the Vatican by transporting antimatter to Rome? Well, there's a tiny detail that's missing in all of these discussions and calculations. And that is, if we were to use all the antiprotons that men have ever made in the history of the universe, and if we would annihilate all of them at the same time, we would not even get enough energy to boil a pot of tea. So clearly, antimatter has all of these properties. It does have annihilation. It is a very efficient process. But at the same time, there's just so few particles, which also makes it one of the most expensive materials in the world. So if we are looking into the future, we talked a lot about cutting edge research, and some of this already looked into where machines like the LHC are going to be developing over the next 10 years. The next step in accelerator research is really to shrink things. And again, talking about Hollywood films, the Inner Space film is probably a good example, where they had this tiny robot that entered into a human body. So what we are trying at the Cockcroft Institute is we are trying to miniaturize accelerators. We are trying to make them 1,000 times, maybe even more compact than accelerators that exist at the moment. And we are working with our international partners, and this is really going to be one of the next big breakthroughs, making particle accelerators more accessible and, for some applications, creating accelerators that can fit into the palm of your hand. The institute that I've mentioned a few times and that you can also see in Wendy's background photographs is the Cockcroft Institute on the campus of Darsbury Lab. And that's the International Center of Excellence for Accelerator Research. And that's where me, my group, and all of my colleagues at Cockcroft are carrying out accelerator research. Now, there's still one question that I have to answer from the very beginning before then coming also to some of your other questions. And that's the question related to the flash. Can particle accelerators create superheroes? Well, what I would say, every scientist probably has some sort of superpower.
That's amazing. I feel like I need to clap at this point. It's almost like Elvis has left the building. Wonderful. So I realise it's now 9 o'clock. It's now 7 o'clock, sorry. So for those that can hang on a little bit longer, we have still got a couple of questions we could probably get through. But we'll keep it quite simple, I think. We've made a note of all these questions that have come in and we're absolutely blown away with them. It's hard to get through so many, that's the trouble. But we have made a note of them and we'll see if we can address them. One that's come in is from a teacher, actually, Caroline. If a student wanted to work on proton therapy, which is a really hopeful idea, which A levels would you encourage them to study?
So I think going into mathematics and physics is definitely not a disadvantage. I think mathematics is key. Also biology, chemistry could be a good basis for then later after university studies going into that direction.
Okay, wonderful.
Especially because Caroline mentioned pupils. At Darsbury, Wendy, we have a fantastic summer placement program and internship program for pupils of different ages, and they can spend time with us between a week and sometimes several months. And these young teenagers and university students, they do absolutely fantastic work, and they do enjoy very much working with us. We have even offered them now over the last year during COVID times, realizing virtual internships and really getting them in touch with the technologies that we are developing. So if you have students that fall into that category, by all means, please do put them in touch with us.
Yes, it's a really good point. And I'm really glad that you raised that question, actually, Caroline, because we do run a fantastic, vibrant program. And if anybody is interested in knowing a little bit more about that, please just email in, because we can answer all of your questions on that. We're still running our programs virtually. We're doing our very best under difficult circumstances, but we've got a very fantastic, vibrant program on the make. So there you go. I think we're going to have to leave it there, to be honest with you, Carsten, because I'm worried that people have got tea to get and children to get to bed and whatever. So I'd just like to thank you so much. This talk has been really informative, but it's also been a lot of fun. It's had a lot of interaction, and I think it's going to make a lot of people question when they watch things in future, even TV programs like Casualty. That's what I'm thinking about. So it was really great fun. And I think it's wonderful that even though you're a very busy man and you've got a challenging but exciting career, you still take the time to engage audiences like this, which I think is really inspirational. So I hope everybody has enjoyed the talk today. I know we've had a lot of questions. We have taken snapshots of them all, so we'll see what we can sort of work on with that. But we would love you to fill in our survey. Once you click off today, a survey will pop up, and we need to hear your feedback. So if you could possibly get in touch with us that way through the survey, it'd be wonderful. Our next talk is going to be in February. And this is a talk based on STF's role working with scientifically focused businesses and the growth of the Northwest Space Cluster. Did you even know we had a space cluster in the Northwest? So if you want to find out a little bit more about that, please do join us. We have three fantastic staff that are going to help out with that talk. It's all quite intriguing. So finally, I'd like to thank you, Carsten, for supporting us and delivering today's talk. It's been an absolute delight to have you. And such an interesting topic, really, really engaging. I'd like to thank the public engagement team working in the background, Phil and Gemma, doing an awesome job as usual. But I'd like to thank you, the public, for joining us. I can see our reach is growing now because we're spreading more and more because we're able to do these virtual events online. I've actually got sisters from Wigan, Suffolk, Wiltshire, a brother in St. Helens and a son in Runcorn all tuning in as well tonight. So I hope everybody stays safe and well, and you stick with us in 2021 so we can bring you a little piece of the wonders of science into your home. So take care, everyone, and we hope to see you next time. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. This is just a follow-up on the Talking Science talk that covered Hollywood physics and the many questions that we have received. I thought I should take the time to reply to every single one of you. Thank you for your questions and give you some answers to the best of my ability. I've grouped them in blocks that more or less follow the layout of the lecture. The first big area concerns medical applications and the proton and heavy ion beam therapy that I covered in the seminar. And one of the questions was about how is the depths in the body adjusted? And well, that is done by tuning the energy of the particle beam. So the penetration depths in the body is direct function of the energy of the beam. So when we know where we would like to go, we can simply tune the energy of the particle beam to that energy or range, and then we will deliver the dose exactly where it should be. The next question in medical applications is about ion beams. And the question is whether it means that because the energy is delivered at a very specific depth, that we also have to adjust the angle and calculate the angle depending on a particular patient's anatomy and the size and position of the tumor. Yes, we have. And that's what in the film you saw by looking at the gantry, the beam delivery system that actually rotates around the patient. So once we know where the tumor is located in the body, medical experts will provide a treatment plan, and this takes into account all of these factors, and they will then tell the machine operators from what angle and at what energy they would like what type of beam to be delivered. How many patients at once can be treated with one particle accelerator? Well, usually that is one patient that is treated at a time, but these treatments are not very long. So patients are being prepared in parallel treatment rooms at these facilities, and every accelerator can indeed serve several treatment rooms at the same time. So the accelerator really is an investment that benefits many patients that receive treatment in a number of treatment rooms at these facilities. The next question is about whether this new equipment for cancer patients will also need specialized doctors and nurses to use them, or
whether the normal doctors and nurses would be suitably qualified. Well, it depends a little bit on the type of treatment. It is certainly correct that a synchrotron proton beam facility is quite a complex infrastructure, and it does require a team of experts for the machine as much as for the dose delivery system. An easier system is based on a cyclotron, and that's, for example, the new facility that is being established at Liverpool. And a cyclotron is much more like a turnkey system, but still, it does require highly specialized oncologists to really develop the treatment planning together with radiation therapists and specialized nurses. So it is a very advanced technology that also requires advanced infrastructure and suitably trained experts. The last question in that area was around why proton beams are only suitable in some cases. Would they not be better in all scenarios? Well, there's hundreds of different types of cancer nowadays, and proton beams really have that distinct advantage that they can deliver a very well-defined dose to a very specific region of the body. But there are cancers that spread all over the body. There is skin cancer, for example. So there's a lot of varieties where it wouldn't be an advantage to use proton beam over more conventional forms of therapy. And that's why we have the oncologists, the experts, the radiation therapists that tell us for what particular cancer type, what type of treatment is ideal. There were also a number of questions related to the creation of new elements. And the first one was about how often are new elements actually created or discovered? And as I said in the seminar, sometimes it can take years to really ultimately verify a new element. So it is a marathon, much more than a short race to create these elements. Who gets to name the new elements? That is typically down to the place that scientists, the collaboration who discovered the elements first and that can claim ownership. And in the past, elements were named after places, after regions, and sometimes after the scientists that first made the discovery. What is the purpose of creating new elements, and can we design their properties? Well, the purpose really is to understand whether our fundamental understanding of nature is correct. There are certain predictions when it comes to very heavy elements. For example, there's a very long-standing prediction that there should be at some point be an island of stability. So for very heavy nuclei that normally decay very, very quickly and are not found in nature easily or at all, there is a theoretical prediction that at some point we should reach an island, a combination between neutrons and protons in the core of a nucleus that create once again stable nuclei that may also exist in nature. And maybe we just don't know that they are there because they only exist in very, very small quantities. So it is very fundamental knowledge that we are after, and that helps us to understand nature in all of its facets. That's far away from designing elements with specific characteristics. So it's really more the fundamental side of science that is considered in these experiments. Do they not exist in nature because of the energy levels required to create them in the first place, or because their lifespans are so short? So the energies to create them, if we go back all the way to the times of the Big Bang or some of the events of cosmic proportions, they have enormous energies associated with them, much higher energies than what we can ever realize in a particle accelerator. So if we manage to create something in an accelerator, then chances are that process has also happened elsewhere in the universe. But the second point is very important that was raised, and that's the short lifespan. Most of these heavy elements have incredibly short lifetime spans, and that's why we think they don't exist in nature. And the last question in that block and linked to that, which is the artificial element that has the longest lifespan? So these studies are still ongoing, and there is hope that we may identify new elements in that island of stability. But if you take, for example, element 117, which is one which hasn't even been named yet, this one has a lifespan which is remarkably long, of 11 hours. Now, to detect, to identify that element, it took many experiments at different places, actually, and there are very few laboratories in the world that can do that. And on average, experts only managed to create around one atom of this new element per week. So the production rate is incredibly small, and that's also why it's so difficult to identify them. A question concerning computing power and the grid: who has access to all the data generated by a computing grid from a particle detector? So a lot of science these days is open access, and there are a number of databases that provide freely access to the data generated in detectors or in other ways through the experiment. So if you are interested in a very particular area of science, you can reach out to these collaborations, and in principle, you could get access to the data. There are even citizen science projects like at SETI from home, where you help experts by providing some of your computing power to look for extraterrestrial life, for example, or to identify the structure of new proteins, or help in virus research and many other things. So there are ways of how you can use your computing power at home to contribute to a worldwide effort. A few questions came in related to antimatter. The one about the X-33 airplane and whether it's based on the British-French Concorde supersonic jet. Yes, I think so. The book doesn't describe in detail what type of technology is used for the jet. They only say that it allows scientists to reach any place on this planet in just a couple of hours. And I guess it was inspired by the Concorde. Do antiparticles travel back in time? That's an interesting question, as we are still looking into the property of antimatter. Our understanding is that antimatter is the mirror particle of matter particles, and that fundamentally the way that they interact is that when they meet each other, they annihilate. So there's 100% conversion of their mass into energy, and it is not normally considered in theories that they are traveling back in time. If matter and antimatter destroy each other when they meet, why doesn't antimatter get destroyed immediately after it's made? That's a good question. And the only way to prevent that it immediately annihilates is by creating a very, very good vacuum. Because if the vacuum is very good, then there is nothing around that antimatter could touch. Because you are quite right, the moment that antimatter gets into interaction with matter, it will annihilate, and that's the end of the antimatter particle. And the last question is, what does antimatter look like? Well, that's exactly what we are trying to find out. We want to find out what the properties are of antimatter particles like antihydrogen. We want to understand its energy levels. We want to understand how it behaves in the gravitational field of the Earth. We want to understand how it interacts with other particles. And there's still a lot that we have to learn. So I don't have a final answer to that question, but we are trying to find out more and more about this exotic particle. And then a number of questions that were more general, I think, about different aspects that I covered in the talk. Can the work at CERN tell us anything about dark matter? Yes. So dark matter and also dark energy research is a very hot topic in modern physics. And some accelerator experiments are actually designed to possibly detect dark matter particles. So far, that hasn't been successful, but that's definitely one of the areas that the community is pushing for. Is it possible to create a black hole? And I guess the question is it possible to create a black hole in an accelerator? Because that's what was covered in the seminar. There are black holes in the universe. We have observed them directly, and that was a breakthrough just a few years ago. Creating a black hole in an accelerator is very, very, very unlikely. I mean, if you look at the energies that are created in such a in such an experiment or in such an event, then these energies are huge. There are some theories that talk about the creation of tiny black holes, but that's nothing like these galactic star eaters that you know from science fiction films. These would be very small black holes at microscopic or submicroscopic scales, and some theories use them to explain certain aspects, but there's no need to worry about anything bad being generated by an accelerator. A few years ago, there was a lot of excitement in the newspapers when some researchers at CERN thought they had detected a particle that moved faster than light. What happened? Did we really detect tachyons, or did somebody just make a mistake? It was the latter. There were actually a number of mistakes. There was a broken connector. There was some problems in the error analysis. But I think what was important is the pathway towards finding out what went wrong. Scientists at the time, they did a very thorough analysis of the data and they couldn't find any mistakes. And they ended up with a result that told them these particles, these signals, they have traveled faster than the speed of light. And that was, of course, something everybody thought wouldn't be possible. And that's when they reached out to the worldwide scientific community and told everybody, look, can you help us look into the experiment, see if there's anything that's wrong, and as a test and prove that theory for being correct, or test it wrong. And that's always the approach that science is taking. Every theory is only as good as until the time that it's disproved by an experiment. So in this case, it turned out that there were no particles traveling faster than the speed of light, and that indeed it was a measurement mistake. What difference would it make to build an accelerator on Earth compared to, for example, the International Space Station? Well, we've talked in the seminar about small effects that really impact on the motion of a particle beam in an accelerator. For example, the arrival and departure of trains in the area around Geneva. So on the International Space Station, fundamentally, gravity would play a very different role to compared to what we have on the Earth. And the gravitational field is an effect that is being taken into account in beam control. So the control system would have to take that into account. Otherwise, in space, it would be easier to create a vacuum, where I should say that the vacuum in the LHC, for example, is better than the vacuum that is found in outer space. So even there, we would have to work with a vacuum chamber and make sure we have similar conditions than what we have in the LHC. Nuclear reactions can create electrical energy, or I guess energy of various kinds. Are there some systems that can potentially create energy more efficiently? So accelerators can potentially be used to create energies. There are schemes like accelerator-driven subcritical reactors. So scientists are looking into ways of using particle accelerators to also create energy. That goes beyond what we covered in the seminar, but if you have particular questions about that area, by all means, do reach out to me, and I'll be more than happy to have a discussion with you. Has being a physicist changed my view of the world and your approach to problem solving? I think one of the strengths of physicists are, and we always say this to our existing and prospective students, is that kind of problem solving ability, no matter what area you're looking at to. And certainly physics, whether it's the macroscopic physics in terms of astrophysics or microscopic considerations in atomic or nuclear physics, that has changed my view of the world over time. Quantum mechanics has many concepts that are very intriguing and that do not immediately couple with what we experience every day. So clearly, when you become a physicist, there is some things that change your view of the world, but they are all very, very positive. What would be your dream scientific discovery or breakthrough? Well, I guess, humankind faces a number of formidable challenges and open questions. We need to find more energy efficient ways of of living altogether. We need to, find better ways of caring about the environment. Global warming is one of the areas where a lot of effort will be needed. In terms of scientific questions and breakthroughs, we've talked about fundamental forces in the seminars, and there are theories that are trying to combine the existing four fundamental forces. So the question is, are these really all that fundamental, or were there maybe other forces, maybe only at the very beginning of the universe, that are even more fundamental? And I think that is something that scientists are after and that I would be very interested in finding out more about. What are my favorite books or books that I could recommend to expand scientific knowledge? I do like the books of Dan Brown, not only Angels and Demons, but also many others that he wrote. He has a great attention to detail, and the science that he talks about is actually very close to what we are actually doing. So he did put quite some effort into finding out what is science and what is fiction. In the Marvel movies, the superheroes travel time by entering the quantum realm. And is this just fiction, or is there a possibility that this can happen in real life? So Hollywood has a lot of interesting concepts, including time travel, including teleportations, like what you see on Star Trek. And I guess that's kind of dreams that humankind is after. And at the same time, it's also something where science wants to find out, is it possible one way or another, and could we potentially do that? For time travel, I think one of the very interesting experiments at the moment is to look into correlation and how particles that are related with each other, but spatially separated, how they can communicate. And there are experiments that at microscopic scales have shown that information might be transmitted at velocities faster than the speed of light. And ultimately that would be time traveling if you then go to macroscopic scales. That's still a very, very long way off from what Hollywood suggests, but it is a very interesting area of science. Is it possible to create a Terminator with the resources that we now have at our disposal? Not in the way that they are shown in the Terminator movies, but there are robots that have amazing capabilities, and they are used in every aspect of life. And the advent of artificial intelligence, or the Industrial Revolution 4.0, as it is also referred to, is really a revolution that is expected to have one of the most dramatic impacts on humankind in our history over the next 5 or 10 years. If you want to see the state of the art in robotics, a good company to look at is Boston Dynamics. They build human-like or pet-like robots that have amazing abilities, and they have a number of interesting YouTube videos. So Boston Dynamics would be the one to look for. Has an Iron Man suit that runs on jet fuel been created? There are jet-based suits where at the moment, I think army staff or professional stuntmen have used jetpacks to fly, quite similar to what Iron Man is using. I mean, ultimately, Iron Man can travel with his suit into outer space and has an unlimited resource of power. So we are far away from that. But the idea of having a person flying around with not much more than their own body, I think that's something that we might see in the not too distant future. Will your research be impacted by Brexit? As you had a number of major European Union funded grants, I think one of the positive outcomes of the negotiations between the UK and the EU is that the UK will remain an associate partner in the European Union's framework program. So that's a very large research framework program where we have received in Liverpool a lot of funding over the years. Now, fundamentally, I would say science is all about international collaboration, and the more that is made easier, the better it is for science. It is clear that Brexit will not do anything to simplify international collaboration, and we do see already impact on recruitment, we see impact on research projects on Brexit, and none of this is positive. So I'm optimistic that science will find a way to mitigate these changes, and ultimately that is a political process. But there isn't anything positive in the development of Brexit as such, at least not from my view. How much does it cost to build a particle accelerator? I guess that is very much a function of what energies you are looking into and also what types of particles. That can start with relatively modest amount of money. If you are looking at an electron accelerator for materials treatment, for example, but it goes to incredible amounts of sum if you're talking about the next big particle clasher, which will definitely be a multi-billion pound project. Is an accelerator environment friendly? I don't think that would be a badge one can stick on an accelerator at the moment. However, there are definitely research projects happening that are looking into making them much more environment friendly, from green magnets that consume a lot less energy to finding alternative ways of producing the energy used for an accelerator in the first place. And finally, the last question is about visits to our facilities, I guess, both at Darsbury or at CERN. That's definitely possible. Every now and then there are big open days, and that's when tens of thousands of people from the general public are welcomed onto our labs, and they get an insight into what we are doing, into getting guided tours of the labs. But we can also arrange visits for smaller groups. Right now, that's a bit difficult because access is quite constrained because of the pandemic. But in more normal times, please do reach out, and I'll be happy to help you find a tour guide and have a look at our facilities or do a tour with yourselves. Thanks again for following the seminar, and keep enjoying Talking Science.